Good morning and happy Easter once again today. I'm so excited that you're joining us here today. We have so much joy and hope and life that we want to share with you this morning. We are the church, and that means God is our strong tower no matter what. And it means that in the world, we get to be a light. And if you're on Facebook right now, I just encourage you to start a watch party, share this with people so we can share our life and our joy and our hope with other people. Thank you so much for being with us here this morning. Please clear everything else out of your mind and out of your head, and just pay attention to the Word of God and let it minister to you. Let's begin our worship service today with these words. The Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia. Grace and peace to you in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Risen Lord, we confess to you our fears. Risen Lord, we confess to you our anxieties. Risen Lord, we confess to you our sin. There was another time when Jesus' disciples were afraid and locked away at home on a Sunday. At that time, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overwhelmed, overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Rejoice. Jesus has conquered everything you fear. Your sin is forgiven. Your death is conquered. And life is yours through Jesus. Amen. Please join in this next song, just praising Jesus' name for the life that's ours.
Successes, my esteem, my pursuits, if I lose.
Let's pray. Oh God, by the humiliation of your Son, you lifted up this fallen world from the despair of death. By his resurrection to life, grant your faithful people gladness of heart and the hope of eternal joys through your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first scripture for today comes from Acts chapter 2 in the season of Easter. This is always the historic tradition of the church to hear this history from Acts. And what Peter does today is he helps us identify Jesus as the Messiah. God's Messiah, who was always meant to come and save us, is proven by Easter. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. Fellow Jews, and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. Fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge. And you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. David said about him, I saw the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest in hope, because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead. You will not let your Holy One see decay. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence. Fellow Israelites, I can tell you confidently that the patriarch David died and was buried, and his tomb is here to this day. But he was a prophet, and knew that God had promised him on oath that he would place one of his descendants on his throne. Seeing what was to come, he spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, that he was not abandoned to the realm of the dead, nor did his body see decay. God has raised this Jesus to life, and we are all witnesses of it. The word of the Lord. Our gospel for today comes from John chapter 20. Here we get this wonderful resurrection appearance of Jesus. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now, Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written, that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the gospel of our Lord. Please join in singing the hymn of the day. I want to challenge you today. Some of the things that we're going to talk about are challenging. I want to call you to the new life that God has for you this morning. We're picking up our sermon series now back in the book of 1 Thessalonians. We've been going over this on Wednesday nights and on Sunday mornings. We took a break for Holy Week, but we're back and we're looking now at just a few short verses here from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. These are challenging verses called to a new life. This is what the Apostle Paul writes to us here. Now, about your love for one another, we do not need to write to you, for you yourselves have been taught by God to love each other. And in fact, you do love all of God's family throughout Macedonia. Yet we urge you, brothers and sisters, to do so more and more, and to make it your ambition to lead a quiet life. You should mind your own business and work with your hands, just as we told you, so that your daily life may win the respect of outsiders and so that you will not be dependent on anybody. The word of the Lord. We are here in the season of Easter. We're looking at the life that God has for us. And today he calls us to rise again, to rise into this new life that he has for us. And we're going to look at what this new life is by really just examining most of our time today, just verse 11 of this scripture. We're actually going to take the scripture backwards. We're going to look, first of all, at the productivity of the Christian life. And then we're going to look at the quietness of the Christian life. We're going to look first at the productivity of the Christian life and then at the quietness of the Christian life. Now, before I get into the productivity of the Christian life, I think I need to pull a Paul for a second and say I don't really need to talk about this right now. And then I'm going to go on and do that. And I think it might be important for me to do that because I want to acknowledge that talking about the productivity of the Christian life right now might be just a little bit on the nose because we all want to be more productive right now and we can't be. And I want to acknowledge that. But I also want to talk about it. The Christian life is a uniquely and especially productive life. Paul says that we're to be people who work with our hands. It means a whole lot more than just stop sitting on your hands and do something, obviously. And just for the sake of clarity, I want you to know that it means more than just that God wants all Christians to be farmers or people who paint or people who just work physically with their hands. What Paul is really doing here is he is reissuing right here, right now, for every Christian, the creational mandate. He is bringing us back to what God always had for us. See, when God made humans, he said, "Here's the world. I'm putting it in your hands. Now, take it and make a garden of it." He's calling us to be humans, to do something that matters in the world, to make a dent, to cultivate, to care, to make this place a better place, to work with our hands, to be productive. That's what makes the Christian life a uniquely productive life, because we are in it, you guys. We are in it for so much more than profit or praise. We are in it uniquely to be productive. In the courtroom, in a counseling session, in a corral, in a classroom, in a boardroom, on a sales floor, in a church. God has called us to do something that matters in the world, to make his world a better place. Do you know what I say to young people who want career counseling from their pastor? You know what I say to them? I tell them, stop seeing dollar signs. Start looking at how you can make a difference in the world. How you can provide for yourself and the people that you love. The Christian life is a uniquely productive life. And history shows us that. So many of the world's greatest educators and politicians and leaders and abolitionists and scientists and engineers and sculptors and painters have been, you guessed it, Christians. Who was it who many people acknowledge really kicked off the scientific revolution? That's right. John Newton. A Christian. Who was it who took the foundation of science and made new applications for it? That's right. Einstein. A Christian. Who was it in the Industrial Revolution who was so influential? That's right. Henry Ford. A Christian. And what about today? This is a guy who, not all that long ago in terms of history, he bucked Darwinianism. Darwinianism was so in vogue and so powerful at that time. It said that germs came from spontaneous generation. And he was a Christian. He knew that stuff doesn't come from nowhere. And because he had that theology, and because he was a good scientist, and he did good science, his life is so productive that here today in this pandemic, this coronavirus pandemic, he is still known as the father of all of microbiology. His name, Louis Pasteur. Also, a Christian. The Christian life is a uniquely productive life because we are in it for so much more than profit or praise. And it's also uniquely productive because it's focused. Did you know that this was in the Bible? The Apostle Paul said, mind your own business. It's a Bible verse. Mind your own business. That doesn't mean that, by the way, that you should sit on your back porch and live and let live. We have a whole bunch of Bible passages that contradict that idea, like love your neighbor as yourself. It's not live or let live. So what does Paul mean when he says, mind your own business? It means that love has to have limits. If you think about it, sin is love or desire without limits. See, what's coveting? Coveting is wanting something, wanting to control it, to have it, when it's not yours. It's you not minding your own business. What's adultery? It's a wife trying to be a wife to somebody who's not her husband. It's love or desire without limits. It's not minding your own business. I mean, we all have stories like this, right? You have your stories and I have my stories. There's a person who for years of my ministry came, and this person told me that they came and they came to listen to my preaching. They never became a member. And at first, I thought this person was trying to be helpful. They would come up, and often after I preach a sermon, they'd give me a tip or some kind of criticism about the sermon. But after a while, I caught on because there was never anything positive. I saw that he just really wanted to be the pastor. And it made me wonder, what if this person, instead of coming to church and listening to the sermon, would actually listen to the sermon productively? What if the sermon, like, he would come and just listen and join the church and bloom in faith and hope and love, and instead of criticizing me, would actually, you know, listen, pray for his pastor. It's an amazing phenomenon, is what I'm saying, that there are armchair quarterbacks, and there's backseat drivers, and there's amateur theologians, and there's people who think they're doctors because they've been on WebMD. And as far as I can tell, with just a brief search of the internet, there are a whole lot of people who think that God has called them to be politicians. I'm not trying to be hard. I am trying to challenge you. What if, instead of trying to do everybody else's jobs, we did ours? When we make other people's business our own business, we waste obscene amounts of time and energy and spirituality. What if instead of everybody thinking that they were a politician, they did just what God called them to do, which is to be a citizen and to submit to the governing authorities and to pray for the governing authorities. And then to take all of that energy that they put in a different direction and redirect it to what God has called them to do, which is to love the person who is right there next to them in their lives. I'm not trying to beat anybody up today. I want you to know I'm not just up here pontificating. I had to repent of this earlier this week myself. You know, churches and pastors have had all kinds of different reactions to this pandemic, and I was worrying way too much what they were doing and not focusing on what God has called me to do. Do you know how we break free from this? Trust. Do you know how we just let other people do what they're called to do and we just focus on what we're called to do? Trust. We've got to know God better. See, this is God's world. It's not ours. And it's his job to run this place. Not ours. That means we can let him run it. It means we can do what we're supposed to do, and we can let other people do what they're supposed to do, because God's pretty good at his job. We can let politicians be the politicians. We can let pastors be pastors. Pastors preach sermons and members listen to sermons, and husbands love their wives and give their lives away for their wives and husbands, and wives respect their husbands. You get it. Not to be trite. But you know what I'm saying today? Is when it comes to everybody else's business, let go and let God. And you can. Because God is not only good, he is good at his job. You know what thought I came across the other day? That God used the most powerful man on earth to get his son Jesus to the right place at the right time to have our sins forgiven. Luke chapter 2. Maybe you didn't even notice it. You know, we're busy in Christmas time. We're thinking about the baby Jesus. We're thinking about Mary. We're thinking about Joseph. That's all great. You know what we miss? We miss God. God used Caesar Augustus, the most powerful man on earth, to get his son where he wanted him to be, when he wanted him to be there, to fulfill all prophecy and to make sure that our sins are forgiven. See, God is good at his job. He has all of the power in the universe. And he is also the God who raised Jesus, our Lord, from the dead. He is powerful beyond imagination. He is loving beyond belief. We can trust him. Do you know when I came across that idea about Caesar Augustus? When I stopped worrying about what everybody else was doing as a pastor. And I thought about what I should be doing as a pastor. What if during this time, we let our leaders lead, and we submitted to them, and we prayed for them, and then we got after the business that God has called us to do, which is to love our neighbor as ourselves. This is the life that the risen Jesus has called us to. It's a productive life. It's also a quiet one. The Apostle Paul wrote this to us. He said, make it your ambition to lead a quiet life. You know, I think those words should take us aback just a little bit. I think they can if we think about what we're really ambitious for. And you know how you do that? I think there's three ways you can do that. You can figure out what you're ambitious for by thinking about these three things. First of all, what is it that you want for your future life? Secondly, what do you regret about your past life? And then thirdly, and I think this must be the most purest one, what do you want for your kids? And what do you want for your grandkids? That's how you start getting at what you're really ambitious for. And if you want to see just how radical the Apostle Paul is, with his idea of ambition. I want you to imagine this. Imagine that the Apostle Paul got up and he read these words at a commencement ceremony at a university. Just imagine. He gets up and he says, make it your ambition to have a quiet life where you mind your own business and work with your hands. And the crowds go wild. Not really. Parents want more for their kids. Parents, I'm constantly amazed at this, are incredibly ambitious. You know, it's Mozart in the womb, and it's 10,000 hours of practice, and it's athletics this, and it's athletics that, and it's academics this, and it's academics that. Parents are so incredibly ambitious for their kids. What's it all for? I read this quote from a satirical magazine called The Onion. Kind of gets at what I'm talking about. The satirical article goes like this. Longtime acquaintances confirmed this week that local Michael Husmer, an unambitious 29-year-old loser who leads an enjoyable and fulfilling life, still lives in his hometown and has no desire to leave, claiming that the aimless slouch has never resided more than 2 hours from his parents and still hangs out with friends from high school. Sources close to Husmer reported that the man, who has meaningful, lasting personal relationships and a healthy work-life balance, is an unmotivated washout who's perfectly comfortable being a nobody for the rest of his life. What's it all for? You know, I was thinking about how I parent and how so many people might be critical of me. Do you want to know what I've never said to my daughter? I've never said to her that you can grow up and be whatever you want. Now, I've helped her imagine the possibilities of things that I think she'd be good at. But I've never said to her that you can grow up and be whatever you want. You know why not? Number one, it's impossible. Lots of people, lots of little kids right now want to grow up to be president. They can't all be president. Number two, it's impossible for her. See, God has made us creatures. And while all of us have tremendous potential and we have tremendous ability and we can be different things, we don't have limitless potential. I can't be whoever I want to be. I don't have every gift. I'm a creature. I'm not a God. And number three, I don't want my daughter to grow up and think that this world is her oyster. It's not. I do not want her to grow up and try to get out of this world whatever she wants to take out of this world. That's selfish. I want my daughter to grow up and love and serve this world in exactly the ways in which she's qualified to do it. So what's it all for? Why do so many people strive for big lives, not quiet lives? Crazy lives, adventurous lives, not quiet lives. Why? The cartoonist Tim Kreider wrote this. He says, busyness serves as a kind of existential reassurance, a hedge against emptiness. See, to put that into biblical and theological terms, why are people living so hard? Why are they trying so hard? Why are they strive? Why are they doing that for justification? They want to feel good about themselves. They want to feel successful. And they want to feel like they matter. They're striving for a justified life. You know, it's sad if you think about it. So many of this world's most marvelous things, you know, you go off and and you make the fastest engine for NASCAR. You come up with the most innovative financial instruments for Wall Street. You come up with a cure for coronavirus. You can do all of those things for the sickest reasons, because you want to feel better about yourself. These are people, as the Apostle Paul says just above this, these are people who do not know God. They do not know the God who justifies. The God who gives us a verdict. That's what justification is. The God who gives us a verdict of accepted, of loved, of worthwhile, of forgiven in his Son, Jesus Christ. The God who looked at us when we were living selfish and ambitious lives for our own justification, those sick and insidious lives, and he sent his Son to die for us while we were living those lives. See, I think it's maybe appropriate that I'm preaching this sermon on the Sunday right after Easter, because in another place, the Apostle Paul said that Jesus rose from the dead for our justification. We don't have to live busy lives to be busy. We can live quiet lives, resting in Jesus. We don't have to strive, strive, strive. We can rest in the finished work of Jesus on our behalf. We don't have to become righteous. We already are righteous in God's Son, Jesus. See, all of us Christians have been given the tremendous gift of a quiet, loving life. That's our gift. You know, nobody else could say that kind of life. Other people can be nice, but they can't be good, because good things come from a good heart. And they can't be loving, because love comes from a selfless heart. You can't be good unless you've already been declared good. Because if you're trying to be good, then the good thing you're trying to do actually makes you a bad person, because you're doing it for yourself. And if you're doing something to be justified, it's actually a bad thing, because you're doing it for yourself. See, Christians have been given the gift of a life where we can go and do something good, not to be good, but because we already are in Jesus. We can go and do something not to be justified, but because we already are in Jesus, we are the only ones who can live a quiet, loving life. And that's a gift. Do you know what I want for myself more and more and more? Just that. You want to know my regrets are in life? I'll tell you what they're not. It's not that I passed up jobs with more money. It's not that I failed to take more adventures. You know what my only regrets are in life? Not loving people more. And do you know what I want for my future? I don't need to be a sought-after counselor. Do you know what I want? To know my wife's heart better. And do you know that it doesn't matter to me that I'm a recognized preacher? You know what I want? What I really want? I want the people that I pastor at this church to be able to say about me, he was a man who led me to the green pastures of the love of Jesus. And I don't need to have a bazillion people to come to my funeral. You know what I want? I just want my daughter to know who I am. Do you know what I want for my daughter? It'd be nice if she helped her poor old dad, maybe got a scholarship to college, but it doesn't really matter to me. I don't care if she works at a fast food restaurant or for a Fortune 500 company, or if she raises a gaggle of kids at home. I don't care. I know that God's going to take care of her. He's always taking care of his people. He's not going to start failing with her. You know what I want for her? I want her to have a rich and abundant life where she knows God and where she loves people the ways in which she is uniquely qualified to love them. And do you know what I want for you? I have the same ambition for you that my grandpa had for his oldest grandchild, who happened to be my big brother. When he was born, my big brother, my grandpa wrote a poem, and it went like this. What's he going to be? A pastor, a teacher, a farmer, just like me? What's he going to be? I guess we'll have to wait and see. What's he going to be? A Christian, just like you and me. God has, in many ways, for so many of us, pressed the pause button in our lives. What if we all took this moment and we thought about what was worth going back to once the world opens up again? The lives that God has given us in the risen Jesus, lives that are so productive and quiet and loving for him. Dear Christian, live. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I thank you for the calls that you've given us in life, the call to discipleship, where we know that we've been justified and forgiven through you, Jesus, your life, your death, your resurrection. And I pray, Lord, that your people hear your voice today to live a quiet, productive life for you and for people. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to invite you, church, in just a second to confess the Nicene Creed that we'll say here in just a moment. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. This time I want to invite you to pray. You can see everything that you need on the screen, and there is a place for you to join in. Let's pray at this time for our country. Almighty God, we acknowledge with thanks all that we have and enjoy, is a gift from your gracious hand. We come before you with heartfelt appreciation for our nation and its people. Hear us as we hold her up to you in prayer. Look on her with favor. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We ask you in this grave moment to protect our workers and our economy. Be with those in financial trouble. Move through us to feed the hungry, house those without homes, and care for those who are struggling. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Be with those who lead us, our president and his advisors, our governors and their advisors, and all those who are in authority at this time. Give them wisdom, love, and strength to act with justice, courage, honesty, and strength. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Keep our financial institutions secure. Bless our fields that they may produce abundant harvests. Guard us against any further calamities. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Strengthen homes in our nation. Where there is domestic abuse in this time, Lord, stop it. Make this a time where husbands, wives, and children serve each other in love. For those who are alone or isolated, give them a special measure of your spirit that they may know your presence at this time. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Hear us now, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. We bring all these things to you in Jesus' name, who also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with his favor and grant you his peace. Thank you.
Upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
Thank you so much for being with us here again. Happy Easter to you. The Lord is risen. If you'd like to bless our ministry here at Peace, you can do that by mailing something to us here. And I believe those things are all online for you to find, 202 Richland Avenue, Aiken, South Carolina. And then also you can give online on our website. And finally, I want to invite you. We've been taking apart the book of 1 Thessalonians together in sermons, but also on Wednesday nights. And I'd love for more of you to come on Wednesday nights. You can look at our emails for more information about that. We've been gathering together on Zoom. Thank you so much for being here. Lord, be with you. If you're here in the South right now, my prayers are with you and for the rest of the South as we go through what seems to be a dangerous day. Lord, keep us all safe. He's promised to do that for Jesus' sake. Thanks for joining us.